been on camera this whole time. You're all aware, right? If that hadn't been the case, but you already forgot about it, right? You're not thinking about being on camera. However, if all of a sudden right now I brought a camera in and I put it on you, and you're all, everything that you have said has been recorded, you're all being recorded somewhere or another. But if I just brought the camera in and put it on you, everyone would say, gee, it makes me nervous. Well, yeah, sometimes the staff are nervous because they're not used to having somebody coach them and being there and suggesting stuff. And the more you do it, the more everybody gets comfortable in that whole process. I wish you would leave me alone. I know what I'm doing, right? Step two. With all my other responsibilities, I have no time to coach. I love that. That's the number one. Now, are you ready? I'm not going to say anything. I'm going to bring this up and just watch what happens on this slide. Are you ready? All that stuff. Golly. And most of it you wouldn't even be doing if you were coaching to begin with. All that time you're spending, you know, on a medication error, there probably wouldn't have been a medication error if we were spending more time coaching staff and doing medications. You wouldn't be filling out an injury report for somebody's self-injurious behavior if we spent more time coaching the staff on how to deal with that person and what are the triggers that cause it. I mean, if you look at a lot of this stuff, you know, whatever we can get rid of. What is the bowel movement record? You know, the agencies still do this craziness. I got a whole section on that. I mean, can you believe that? I mean, you understand that all of our clinical records need to be clinically determined? In other words, there are people who you should be doing a bowel movement record on when they have a history of difficulty in bowel movement, but there would be no reason to do it. Now, when you have an agency where staff lack the intelligence and knowledge to make that decision, then you do everything for everybody all the time. That's what that's about. That's pretty sad, right? Number three, I feel like I'm intruding on the privacy of those supporting. When we coach, we are intruding on people's privacy. On Thursday, when I go into that home, I will be intruding on people's privacy. I will be in the bathroom. I'm going to be there when they're eating breakfast. That's intrusive. I don't want to be intrusive. People have a right to privacy. However, they have even a more important right than privacy. They have a right to capable and competent staff. If you can tell me how I can get staff to be capable and competent without intruding on somebody's privacy, I'll be the first to do it. I don't know how to do it. So, yeah, I don't want to be intrusive, and I'm always asking people, is it okay if I come into the bathroom and be here with your staff to give them some suggestions? And sometimes people will say no, but usually it's yes. The staff never do what I tell them anyways. Well, that's that relationship issue, right? When you're on with people, they're less likely to behave in a way to disappoint you. As we have said several times, how do you need to behave in order to bond with your staff? I'm concerned about offending the staff if I tell them this is how you should be doing this or that. It's how you tell them. We're not telling people that they're doing something wrong. We're trying to get a proposition, trying for them to get the answer. I'm here all the time. Here's the dangerous one. I'm here all the time. I know what's going on. Oh, well, excuse me. If you were here all the time, you know what's going on. Why didn't you see that person has their face in the plate? If you were here all the time, why didn't you see that person puts their hand on their tires for their mobility issues? If you're here all the time, why didn't you see that person can't tie their shoes and the staff have to tie them for you? If you're here all the time, why can't you see that person's leaving their home with a soiled sweatsuit on? Here's the problem. How do you find the word here? Here is not having a physical presence. It's more than a physical presence. It's putting these glasses on. These lenses. The gym lenses. Now I'm here. You just being there won't do it, folks. Trust me. You got to put the glasses on. Then you're there. What's your excuse? By your pupils, you are taught. That's a really good one. Okay, I go to a home. I like this one. This will help you out because I want you to be comfortable. I go to a home, and the staff turns to this guy and says, Bob, come into the bathroom and I'll help you and I'll put your clean colostomy back on. Come into the bathroom and I'll put your clean colostomy. Now, you know, as a coach, the first thing I'm thinking is the language, right? Because what you should be saying, Bob, come into the bathroom and I'll assist you in putting your colostomy back on. And also, it should be said in such a way that I never would have heard it. Put that all aside. I say to Bob, by the way, I don't even know what a colostomy bag is. You could walk in here with one over your head as a hat. I wouldn't know how to help you do it. So I say to Bob, would it be okay if I come into the bathroom and watch how the staff assist you in putting your colostomy, you notice my language, assist you? So I said, you can come in. So I go to the bathroom, and there's a linen closet in the bathroom with the colostomy supplies in it. The staff go into the door and put their hand on the doorknob. What do I do? What do I do? I lean on the door, and I look at him. That's all I have to do. She's got it. You understand, I don't have to know anything about a colostomy bag. I'm going to learn about a colostomy bag. From my pupils, I will learn. That's what I want you to understand, or you're not going to be comfortable in doing this. Do support staff in your agency fear that they will be injured? I have a woman come up to me in a session like this, and she says, Tom, I want to talk to you sort of privately. Can we go over here? She says, I'm 4.5 months pregnant, but nobody knows. I haven't said anything of work. So, congratulations. She says, the reason I want to talk to you is that I am scared to death to go to work. There is a man who lives in the home. He's a very large guy. When I go to get him up in the morning, he's really violent. He strikes out. He tries to hit. And I'm really fearful for the welfare of my child, and I'm carrying it myself. I said, gee, I absolutely understand. I said, does your supervisor, there in the morning to give you some direction and support you when he gets up? Oh, no, Tom. He has to get up around 6 o'clock because he goes to the sheltered workshop. My supervisor usually gets in about 7:30. She has child care responsibility. She can't. I said, when do you have a behaviorist or psychologist? And, oh, yeah, we have a behaviorist under contract. Well, I said, what about him or her? Oh, no, no, Tom. They come in the afternoon, and they sit on the sofa with the clipboard doing observations. I'm not making this up. And that's what that staff has to live with, because no one will come to try to help her out. Let's all figure out what we're going to do with this man and why he is conducting this the way he is. There's no coaching going on. Staff, the word is out on the street. You just relieved 2 staff from duty because, and by the way, when you relieve somebody from duty, that's a personnel issue. No one's supposed to know. Well, you know how the doggone grapevine goes. They've been relieved from duty. And the word out on the street is they violated somebody's rights. But guess what's really fascinating? These 2 staff were talking to each other in Spanish. They were talking in Spanish but used several vulgar words. The person who they were doing it in front of was totally deaf. It was found out that they were using that language, but no one else would have understood what they said. Another staff finds out that, by the way, is that considered verbal abuse, yes or no? Absolutely. It makes no difference whether the person can hear it or understand it. It's still, I know it's complicated, but trust me. And other staff are saying, well, I didn't know if somebody didn't understand what you were saying that it's abuse. Well, that's because these staff were not being coached. They fear that they're going to violate somebody's rights or making documentation errors. The agency just went through an audit and they have to pay back over $250,000 in Medicaid waiver because the documents completed by the staff were not considered valid. They only were reviewed after the fact, and when they're completing their documentation, there was never any coaching going on during the process. All the training was class training, or they put them in an office and tried to explain it to them. They were never there to coach them when they were documented. Or unable to respond to an emergency situation. There's this guy. He weighs 230 pounds. Big guy, 6'2". And he aspirates, and he has problems choking. And he does choke occasionally. And the staff are thinking, what am I going to do? I can't even get my arms around him to try to use him. I can't get him down on the floor to do anything. And there's no one there to try to explain what it is they're supposed to do. And staff working in fear, believing that they don't have the support of their other colleagues if somebody has a serious conduct issue. It is imperative that supervisors and clinicians have a presence providing support staff with an IPJIT coaching. Now, since I'm running tight on time, I want to talk about a schedule. This session that you're looking at, like the one yesterday, is huge. There are hundreds and hundreds of slides in this presentation, okay? All of these slides will be available to you. But there's a couple comments I want to make because we may not be able to cover them. And I want to talk about schedules for a moment. What I would be looking for is that each of you, as a manager supervisor, complete your schedule. I'm giving you my guidelines. On the 20th of each month for the following month. That's number one, and I'll tell you why. Your schedule is influenced. The schedule, the hours when you work, not how many hours you work. I'm not saying that. I don't expect the number of hours that you work to be over whatever they normally would be, 38 or 40. I understand stuff happens, by the way. You have to cover. I got all that. But that should be the exception. So I'm not as concerned how many hours you work. I'm concerned when you work. The hours that you work, and those of you who are supervising other managers in here, hopefully you're really listening, are not determined by the hands on the clock. They're determined by the programmatic and clinical needs of the people being supported and the training needs of the staff. Those are the two things. Got it? I'm going to say it again. The hours when the manager works are determined by the training needs of the staff and the programmatic and clinical needs of the people being supported. Generally, what you would find is that a supervisor of a residence would be working two early mornings a week at wake up, one Sunday day a month, one overnight per quarter, one or two evenings from 3 to bedtime a week. Do not do that if the place that you are responsible for is already running perfectly and people understand everything that we're talking about. If they don't, I know of no other way to fix it. Now, here's the best part, if you're smart. What I just gave you was a benefit to the job, if you're smart. Because when you develop that schedule, your personal life must come first. So you're saying to yourself, I got to make a dentist appointment next month. And I'm going to make it on a Monday afternoon. You don't have to take any sick time. I want to take 4 days off consecutively. You don't have to take any annual leave. You try to build the schedule to enhance the quality of your personal life while simultaneously meeting the programmatic clinical needs and training needs of the staff. No one can come back and say that you have misused the schedule, because when you complete your schedule, excuse me, someone want to come up and change my batteries real quick so I can keep talking. When you complete your schedule, can y'all hear me, because this is the important part, it goes to your supervisor. Your supervisor wouldn't be approving it if they didn't think it was appropriate. So no one can come back and say, well, those 4 days you took off and you didn't take any annual leave, you're just trying to rip some. No, no one can say that. Your supervisor approved it. Now, I have no idea how that fits with your current system. Some of you may already be on that kind of system. I have no idea, right? But I'm just saying, generally what I find in a group like this, 90% of the people in the room will be working what basically looks like a Monday through Friday first shift schedule. That's what you normally see when I go out. That, to me, is the reason and the explanation why the quality of life of the people we support is not where it needs to be.
Thank you. There are no batteries here, so I won't be doing it. I don't see any extra batteries. We have to put them this morning.
Wait a minute. Here, hold it. Okay, so any questions on the schedule? Now's the time to ask any questions on the schedule. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, can I repeat this question? Yeah, I'm just going to do it. It's also when you get this. But what I'm generally looking for is two wake-up mornings a week. Because that whole procedure. is about fire evacuations in your homes. Let me just talk about that for a moment. I'm very, very concerned about that. A number of you have folks who have autism, who have a very difficult time transitioning. You try to get them out of bed even in the morning, they don't want to get up. They become very combative. A number of you have folks who are on large amounts of psychotropics that sleep very soundly. Some of you have people who lack the physical ability to get out of bed on their own because they can't walk or can't even transfer themselves to a wheelchair. My guess is, and Bob, you can correct me for your program, for your homes, very few, please correct me if I'm wrong, of your residences have fire suppression systems in terms of sprinkler systems. I'm guessing they don't. So this is what we got. My guess is you probably do fire drills, right? My guess is you are trying to do things right and not doing the right thing. My guess is that you may have a requirement in the state of Arizona that says that you do fire drills by shift. Most states do. So my question to you is, when is the last time you did a fire drill? Between 12 a.m. and 3 a.m. Because what happens, you